once more. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for a beautiful Sabbath morning, and thank you for the words that you have impressed upon my husband's heart. And as he speaks, may your spirit be with him, give him words of courage and just to edify our community, and let nothing proceed from his mouth that is not of you. Thank you, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. We're very blessed with a very loving and godly woman. Actually, let me turn this on here. Actually, I really appreciated that from my wife because she probably knows I'm very nervous, actually a little more anxious than usual about today. So the message I'm going to give today is it's going to require a lot of thinking. You're going to have to follow along with me, especially through the first parts. I really don't want to lose you through the first parts, and then I think there's a special message, especially at the end. With that in mind, yes?
Can you pull them off to the side so we can see the picture?
Absolutely,
better?
Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. Any further would be helpful to these
okay.
folks.
Okay, sure.
That's better.
Because she can't read it.
Thank you.
Okay. With that in mind, I might have everyone actually stand up and maybe stretch a little bit, get the circulation going. So that you can, you know, this is actually more for me. So, if you want to just stretch left and right. Okay. I don't know how much this helps the brain, but hopefully it'll help a little bit with the circulation there. Okay. All right, if you've gotten the stretching in, if you can find your seat. I'd actually like to pray again to start us off here. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this Sabbath morning. Thank you for this opportunity to be able to speak to my brothers and sisters and to share a message that I've really, really wanted to share with them. Lord, I pray that you would help me to do this message justice, that you would give me your words to speak, that I would not speak a word more or a word less in that regard. And please just bless this message this morning and bless us with the presence of your Holy Spirit to help us to understand the spiritual things which can only be discerned spiritually. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So the title for the message this morning is Jars of Clay. But before we get into the main part of the message, I wanted to start with a passage in Revelation. And a lot of the texts I'm actually going to have up here, but I'd also appreciate it if you followed along with your own Bibles as well. And in Revelation 19, verse 7 through 9, it starts with the scene that we as Christians look forward to, the hope that we have to look forward to. And it starts, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. And he saith unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. There are a few things that I wanted to... No, there we go. There are a few things that I wanted to point out in this passage. First, that we have this marriage feast that we can look forward to in heaven. I think many of us are familiar with Christ talking about the special marriage celebration feast that we have in heaven once Christ takes us back to heaven. And so we realize that this happens at or after the second coming. I also wanted to point out in verse 7 that the church is referred to as what? Christ's wife, right? The pure woman. Verse 8 says that this church is arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, and that this clean and white linen represents the righteousness of the saints. Okay. So I want to take us to another passage in Matthew chapter 22, carrying with this theme. In verses 1 through 14, we are all familiar with this story, so I usually like to read all the verses, but this time I just have you skim through it yourselves. There's a parable that Christ talks about there in verses 1 through 14, and he says in verse 2, "The kingdom of heaven is like unto a certain king which made a marriage for his son." Again, we have this idea of a marriage and a marriage feast. And at this marriage feast, to summarize this parable, the king, who is the father of the groom, represents God, who is acting as the governor of this wedding feast. We have this concept of a wedding garment again. And the thing that's important here is we realize who provides the garment, right? This robe of righteousness that God provides for all the guests is provided by God. The guests didn't provide it themselves. God provided this robe of righteousness. We also find that at this wedding feast, if you did not have this wedding garment, what happens? You couldn't go, right? You get cast out into darkness, into outer darkness, and in essence, you're lost. Okay. So, the important things I want to recognize here is that there is a wedding feast that we can all look forward to in heaven. That we are to be clothed in a white and pure clothing, which God provides for us. That it is not something that we can earn ourselves, it is a gift that God gives to us. I want us to keep that in mind because, as I said, the title of the message is Jars of Clay. And with this introductory concept in mind, we have to get into the heart of the message. Actually, there's one other thing I have to point out. Another concept that we have to establish before we get into this message is this idea of a living soul. Okay. Now, we are, I see most of us, pretty much all of us here are Seventh-day Adventists, so we should all be very familiar with this concept. In Genesis 2, verses 7, it's written, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." From this verse, we have an understanding, with the support of many other verses as well, that is unique to much of Christendom. We believe that a living soul, that the dust of the ground plus the breath of life from God equals a living soul. So, the dust of the ground, meaning God shaped our physical body, right? The breath of life, which is what he fills us with, this gift of life that God gives to our physical body, that in combination with our physical body equals a living soul. We become a living being. Okay? It's important to recognize this because as I continue with this message, I want to make sure that everyone has this clear in their minds. Okay? There's no ethereal soul that floats around that is separate from the physical body. Okay? The soul is a holistic concept. It is a concept that includes the physical body and the breath of life. And those with those two separated, you cannot have a soul. There is no living soul. Okay. All right. So I wanted to establish that. Now the other point here is From the beginning, God has always been the source and sustainer of life. Written in a different way, in the Desire of Ages, page 785, we read from Ellen White, says, "All created beings live by the will and power of God. They are dependent recipients of the life of God. From the highest seraph to the humblest animate being, all are replenished from the source of life." So, if you take this literally, which I do, where does the devil get his life from? It's from God. He lives only because God has given him life. Okay. From the angel in heaven to you and me, to the humblest animal and plant, we all live because God wills it so. One of the consequences of this understanding is that death then is to be separated from the source of life. Okay. It means that there is no, you know, we don't believe that there's a hell in which people live forever and ever being tormented, because that would mean that God would continually give them life so that they could be tortured for all of eternity. We believe that death is separation from God, and that the biblical concept of hell is eternal separation from God. That is, a cessation of existence forever. There is no consciousness in death. This is a very biblical concept. So, with those basic tenets of biblical Christianity established, let's move on to the message. So this idea of jars of clay, you may have guessed already from the previous text in Genesis that this, that the jars of clay that I refer to as the title, it represents us. Now this concept is not a concept that's unique to a single author in the scriptures. It's not unique to Genesis. We read in Job 10, verses 8 through 9, that Job, when he's talking to God and asking God why all these bad things are happening to him, he says, "Thine hands have made me and fashioned me together round about, yet thou dost destroy me. Remember, I beseech thee, that thou hast made me as the clay, and wilt thou bring me into dust again?" And Isaiah also has this concept. Isaiah 64, 8 says, "But now, O Lord, thou art our Father, we are the clay, and thou our potter, and we all are the work of thy hand." Again, this concept that we are this vessel of clay that God has made. Jeremiah says something similar. Jeremiah 18, 6 says, "O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter, saith the Lord? Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are ye in mine hand, O house of Israel." Okay. We're just repeating all these concepts. Sorry, didn't do that properly. This concept is also not a concept unique to the Old Testament. Paul in Romans chapter 9, verse 20 to 21 says, "Nay, but, O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall a thing formed say to him that formed it, Why hast thou made me thus? Hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor?" And Paul also speaks even more intensely about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. This is an important vessel. This is actually where the term jars of clay comes from. So if you have different versions from the one I have here, this is the King James Version, but if you have some other versions, it actually uses the phrase jars of clay. It says in 2 Corinthians 4, 6 through 7, "For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels." In some of your translations, it should say jars of clay. Okay. "That the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us." What is Paul telling us here about us as jars of clay? Sorry. We ourselves have no power, right? Jars of clay are fragile, they're you know, they're lowly. Okay, but he says within our jars of clay, within our earthen vessels, we have something. What is that that we have? God's glory. Okay, right? It says the glory of God through Jesus Christ can be contained in us, jars of clay. Okay. Is that somewhat powerful? Well, now, let's get into the study of the mechanics of how this happens or what this means. Okay. This is a text that I want everyone to turn to if you have a Bible with you, because this is a text that you will have to follow along with. This is John chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. For the biblical scholars there, you probably know what this story is, okay? And so the picture that I put up there specifically for a reason, you can have an idea as to the cleansing vessels that were used in Jewish times. I found a lot of different pictures. This one seemed to be fairly representative of what's used. Let's read John chapter 2. Starting with verse 1. It says here, and the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. Jesus saith unto them, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast. And they bear it. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother, and his brother, and his disciples, and they continued there not many days. Here we have a story commonly known as, or referred to as, the wedding in Cana. And to kind of summarize this story, We read that Jesus is at a wedding in Cana. And to really simplify the story, basically they run out of wine at this wedding. Now, I'm not going to make a huge point about this, but this is talking about non-fermented wine. Okay? And if you want to explore that further, we can meet later. And Jesus... And as they run out of wine, his mother comes to him and asks him if he could do something about this. And Jesus tells the servants at this feast to fill, how many jars of clay were there?
Six.
Six jars of clay, right? These are pots, water pots. You can refer to them to as being jars of clay. And these 6 jars of clay, they're normally used for what? Cleansing with water. They're purifying purpose. In other words, as you read about this, the water in these pots were frequently used to wash their hands or wash the vessels, or, you know, wash the dishes, I should say, you know. So they basically contain water stored up for this purpose. Okay? This is not drinking water, per se. It wasn't meant for them to draw water to drink from. So Jesus tells the servants to fill the 6 jars of clay with water, and then he tells them to carry this water to the governor of the feast. And the servants carry this water to the governor of the feast, and somewhere in that time, a miracle has happened. And the miracle is that the water has been changed into Not just good wine, excellent juice, excellent grape juice. So, we already talked about this a little bit. In this story, if you were to take this story as a type, if we were to try to see the deeper lessons in this story, you know, John introduces this as the first miracle that Christ did. And I think he does that specifically because he's trying to show us the mission and that Christ has in coming. And this first miracle is to establish why Jesus came. Okay. So let's take a look at this story. The jars of the clay, we kind of looked at this already, we can think of as representing us. What about the water? Is there a scriptural reference as to what the water could potentially represent? Well, if you turn to Ephesians 5, verse 25 to verse 26, there's a section in here that starts off with talking about husbands and what husbands should do. So let me read it. It says, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it." Verse 26 says, "That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word." Okay. This is a concept that is important. The water, many times in Scripture, represents the word of God. Okay. In verse 26 here, it says, "Washing of water by the word." The water, the Word of God, has a certain purpose. It has a certain cleansing purpose. Okay? But we also realize that in John chapter 1, everyone should know John chapter 1, says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Who is this in reference to? This is in reference to Christ, yes? So how is it that Christ is referred to as the Word? How is it that water is a symbol for Word? Well, all Scripture is about Christ, is it not? All Scripture points towards Christ. Christ is the perfect representation of the character of God, which is to say, Christ is the perfect picture of who God is. Yes? So, when we take in, or when we open God's Word, the Bible, and if you believe this, this is what this is trying to point at. When we open the Word of God, we fill our heart with the Word of God, and we fill our heart with Christ because we see a more perfect picture of Christ, of God. A more perfect picture of God every time we open the Word of God. Does this make sense? Like when we open the Word of God, we're not doing this because this is what we have to do. This is like a chore that we have to do. This is how we get to know who God is. This is how we get to know or see a better or more perfect picture of who God is. I don't know how to say that without just repeating myself. but that's what this represents. So when we talk about the wedding in Cana, if the pots are supposed to be filled with water, what does that mean about the pot before they're filled with water? They're empty, okay? They're not full with water, okay? So that's why you have to fill it with water, because, you know, this is a great example to some extent of what God did for us, right? In the beginning of creation, God made man in whose image? God's image, right? We, in the beginning, in creation, Adam was a reflection of who God was. He had within himself, to some extent, God's character. Now, after the fall, the image of God has been corrupted in our beings over time. We don't have, you know, we are sinful. We're sinful human beings. We don't reflect Christ's character very well. The first step that Christ is telling us here in the wedding of Cana is we need to be filled with God's Word. Okay? Now, what is wine? This is a two-step process here. Wine, Matthew 26, verses 27 to 28 says, "And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." Where is this text from? This is a text that we read almost every communion, right? From the Last Supper. Jesus is passing the wine around the table. It doesn't say wine. It says fruit of the vine. And he tells us what wine represents. What does wine represent? The blood. Okay. But blood by itself, well, that's still another symbol. It's a symbol meaning another symbol. So what could that represent? Well, blood, if you remember, in the Old Testament, and as Adventists, again, we should know this with our dietary things. In Genesis 9:4, it says, "But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat." So, what is it saying here? That the blood contains what? Life. Right? Again, in Leviticus, it's repeated in Leviticus 17:11, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul." What does this mean? Well, if the wine represents Christ's blood, and blood represents life, okay? Are you starting to follow a little bit here what I'm getting at? So the summary is, in the wedding of Cana, you have these empty jars of clay. The first step is that they must be filled with water, filled with the Word of God. Now, if you just read the Bible, is that enough to save you? If you were a PhD on Bible studies, is that enough to save you? No, it's not. But it's the first step, right? Understanding the character of God, understanding a picture of who God is the first step, okay? Now, all of us, let's start with this. They fill these containers with water, and we realize, well, Christ commands this, and then what happens is the next step is the miracle. The miracle that occurs, okay, is that once you have been filled with the Word of God, okay, do you understand? Do you see this picture of where Christ tells the servants, okay, now take this water and take it to the governor of the feast. Present it to God. Okay? And these servants carry this water to the governor, and they're thinking, oh man, we're so gonna get in trouble for this. Okay, we're having him drink from these cleansing pots, this water, these cleansing pots. And yet what happens? They take it to the governor. The governor tastes of this water, and he realizes it's been converted to wine. When? It doesn't tell us when. And I think that that's something that's different for each and every person. Right? But we believe that Christ, okay, gives us the power to be presentable to God. Now, what it really is saying is that that word, that knowledge, the light that is in our hearts as to who God is, and by implication, who we are, okay, leads to a transformation in our lives. And instead of being full of water, jars of clay full of water, we become jars of clay full of wine, full of blood, full of life. Make sense. And this is Christ, the life of Christ is what fills us. And all of us who are saved have this promise to look forward to. What I've just presented to you is really the complete gospel message. This is a quote from Gospel Workers. I didn't put the reference there, from Ellen White, but I'll read it to you here. It says, "The solemn, sacred message of warning must be proclaimed in the most difficult fields and in the most sinful cities, in every place where the light of the great threefold gospel message has not yet dawned, everyone is to hear the last call to the marriage supper of the Lamb. From town to town, from city to city, from country to country, the message of present truth is to be proclaimed, not with outer display, but in the power of the Spirit, as the divine principles that our Savior came to this world to set forth in the Word and life are presented in the simplicity of the gospel. The power of the message will make itself felt. In this age, a new life coming from the source of all life is to take possession of every laborer. Oh, how little do we comprehend the breadth of our mission. We need a faith that is earnest and determined and a courage that is unshaken. Our time for work is short, and we are to labor with unflagging zeal. You know, the thing that I didn't mention is the scripture doesn't tell us when the water was turned into wine, but John gives us some insight into this. So in the first chapter, John chapter 1, John talks about God, Christ being the Word. Right? Okay. In the third chapter, the chapter after this wedding in Cana, John describes Christ talking to Nicodemus, telling us about how someone is born again. And what does he say for the Bible scholars out there? He says, how does the Spirit work? He compares it to wind, right? You don't know where it comes from. You don't know where it's going. But somehow, that wind has brought about a change. In the same way, when you fill yourself with the picture of the character of God in your heart, you don't know when it happens. It doesn't happen in an instant moment. It doesn't happen in a specific time. But eventually, at some point, God promises to change that into a new life. Okay. In this quote that I just read, the point that I wanted to really, the line that I wanted to point out is right there in red. I don't know if it's maybe a little small for some of you to read. It's the light of the great threefold gospel message. How many of us think of the gospel message as having three parts? How many of us have seen this before? Well, what are the three parts? This brings us back to John in our scripture reading. There's a very important reason as to why John specifically emphasizes this point. John chapter 19, verses 34 to 35, it says, but this is a picture of Christ hung on the cross, and if you all remember, a soldier does this. So, verse 34, but one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he that saw it bare record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith truth, that you might believe. Do you see all these symbols here? The threefold message of the gospel, the three parts of the gospel message, what are they? We should know, because supposedly we preach the gospel message. Yes? So what is the gospel message? What are the three parts of the gospel message? The first part of the gospel message is that Christ, hanging there on the cross, he died for us. Now, what does that mean that he died for us? It means that he paid for your sins. In other words, he paid the consequence of your sins. If you committed a crime, okay, Christ paid your jail time. Okay? But what does that do? What is that? That's something that he's doing for things in the past, right? So then what John is pointing to here is, yes, Christ died on the cross to pay for your sins, part number one to the gospel message. Most of Christianity, most of Christendom is stuck there. They never move beyond that. Okay? Part two and three is that when the spear pierces Christ's side, what comes out of his side? Water and blood. What is that promise? Part two of the gospel message is that Christ came to this earth to give us a perfect picture of who God is in the flesh. Okay? And that we have the ability, by reading about Christ and through the Holy Spirit, to contain that knowledge within our hearts, within this jar of clay. Part three is that that knowledge by itself is not saving, but through the work of the Holy Spirit can be transformed into new life. So that Christ died for our sins, all the sins in the past are wiped clear. Christ fills us with the knowledge of God, that we can contain a true understanding of who God is and who we are in the whole picture of the universe. And then he gives us the ability through his blood to have his life course through our veins and our arteries to give us new life so that we no longer sin, to have Christ die again. That may not have come out properly, but do you understand this message? The message is that God wants us to return to a place where we perfectly reflect the character of God, the image of God. He doesn't want us to be satisfied with the fact that he's wiped our slate clean. He doesn't want us to be satisfied with all the Bible knowledge we have in our head. He wants us to look to the time when our lives can be transformed so that the life that we live is the life that Christ lived. That is the threefold gospel message. I don't have any more to say on that. If you bow your heads with me, I'd like to close this with prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you for this study, especially as it's been such a blessing just to me, and a blessing and a challenge. And Lord, I pray that my brothers and sisters here could have gained a special blessing as well. May we accept this knowledge, and may we invite the Holy Spirit to transform our lives. May we continually fill ourselves with the Word of God and look forward to that day when you restore us to that perfection that you gave to us in Eden. Please be with us as we part one from another today and with our various activities. As we close this week and begin anew, please help us, transform us, that that we don't have to say a word, that we don't have to preach a single sermon to share the power of God with those around us. And I pray that you'd be with us. Send your Holy Spirit to go with each of us as we return to our homes. We ask and pray in Jesus' name.